Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for our Pride Month live stream. Today, we're going to be talking about Paul Chalfin, who was Vizcaya's artistic director and lived as an openly gay man in the early 1900s. We made a very conscious choice to do this live stream as a live stream instead of a pre-recorded video so that we can have an open dialogue with everyone. We very much want to hear your comments, but we encourage you to please share those in a polite way. We have pasted our community guidelines as a comment so that you can review those. And anybody violating those guidelines will be removed from the stream and potentially banned. So give me 1 second and I will put David on to start the stream. Here we go, David.
Hey guys, I'm David Miller. I'm the collections care technician here at the Vizcaya Museum and Gardens. And we wanted to take this opportunity to talk to you about Paul Chalfin, who is one of the most instrumental figures in the creation of Vizcaya. Paul Chalfin was a 20th century artist, architect, and interior designer. He worked with James Deering, the owner of Vizcaya, F. Burrell Hoffman, the architect, and Diego Suarez, who was the landscape architect, to build, design, and furnish Vizcaya Museum and Gardens. We kind of think of it as his creative vision that united the whole estate. So he kind of gets a lot of credit for why Vizcaya is such a amazing and unique place that people love to come and visit. Now, Paul Chalfin was born in 1874 in New York City. And before coming to Vizcaya, he managed to collect a litany of professional accolades in the world of art. He attended Harvard as a kind of start to his education, and then went to study in Paris under the painter Jean-Léon Gérôme, who was one of the most widely reproduced artists of the 19th century. He also returned to the United States and became the curator in the Department of Japanese Art at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. He studied mural painting in Europe. And when he returned to the United States, he worked with Elsie DeWolf, who was a well-known interior designer. Now, Elsie DeWolf was actually one of the first people that James Deering wanted to be the artistic director here at Vizcaya. And she recommended Paul Chalfin. And that's how they became, how they began to work together. Now, Paul Chalfin's sort of artistic hand can be seen all over the estate. It's really his genius that Vizcaya looks the way that it does. And there's a handful of different objects around Vizcaya that, you know, have his name written all over them. One of the first ones would be this fireplace that I'm standing right in front of. Now, that was a antique fireplace that they bought from a villa in France. It's from the 1500s. And in typical Paul Chalfin style, he decided to kind of jazz it up a little bit before including it here at Vizcaya. So he added the top third of it to kind of complete it before bringing it into the living room here. Now, that's what's known as a pastiche. So if anybody in the comments has been to Vizcaya before and can think of another example of a pastiche, please let us know. And you may even be eligible to win free tickets to come to Vizcaya for July 4th. Now, another sort of classic Paul Chalfin object here at Vizcaya would be the weather vane, which is in the shape of a seahorse. Now, this was actually the subject of a bit of contention between Paul Chalfin and James Deering. This was a little bit of headbutting between them, in that James Deering wanted the symbol of Vizcaya to be the caravel, which is, you know, the type of ship that the European explorers took across the sea to come to the, you know, to the New World. Paul Chalfin preferred that it would be a seahorse. And this was the kind of argument that they got in a lot of different telegram back and forths about. Now, when James Deering was away during the construction of Vizcaya, Paul Chalfin actually had the weather vane completed in the shape of a seahorse, as I mentioned, when in James Deering's mind, it was supposed to be in the shape of a caravel. And this was a pretty sore subject between them. If you take a look at some of the telegrams, you can see that the language between them on this subject was a little bit curt and tense. And I suppose to kind of dissipate that tension, Paul Chalfin actually gifted James Deering the hanging caravel, which now hangs in Vizcaya's East Loggia. Now, James Deering was not the only person that Paul Chalfin sort of butted heads with. In fact, the landscape architect who was responsible for the design of our formal gardens outside argued with Paul Chalfin so much that he actually left And it wasn't until the 1950s that Diego Suarez, the landscape architect, fully received credit for his work out there, because originally a lot of people thought that Paul Chalfin did it. So he was what you might describe as a bit of a strong character, but most great artists are. And again, you know, we wouldn't want to change it because he is responsible for so many of the great things about Vizcaya. Now, after designing Vizcaya, Paul Chalfin went on to continue his artistic career, and he actually returned in the 1930s after James Deering's death and after a hurricane had sort of damaged a lot of the different elements of Vizcaya. He returned to kind of get it back into shape. He was invited by James Deering's nephew-in-law, or sorry, niece, Chauncey McCormick. And it's interesting that he was seen as so instrumental to the vision of Vizcaya that even after it was completed, he was brought back to help repair it after a hurricane. Now, as Alex mentioned in the beginning of this live stream, Paul Chalfin never married and he was openly gay, which was a little unusual for someone in the early 1900s. He had a partner, Louis Albert Coons, who he actually lived on a boat with, called the Blue Dog. Now, the Blue Dog was a gift to Paul Chalfin from James Deering after the completion of Vizcaya, which is, I guess, his way of saying a job well done. Now, later in Paul Chalfin's life, he was with a man named Anthony Cerullo. And on the 1940 census, Cerullo is listed as Chalfin's partner, not as a household member or as a boarder, as his partner. So as we can see, Paul Chalfin was quite open about the lifestyle that he lived, as he should have been. Now, Chalfin died in 1959 and is buried in New Jersey. And as I said, he's responsible for many of the reasons that Vizcaya is so unique. And we're proud to have him as sort of one of our founding members. Now, if anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
So we will give that a minute for questions to come in the comments. If anybody has any questions about Chalfin, or while we're here, really anything about Vizcaya, we're happy to answer that. And we will also give you one more question to potentially answer for admission to come to Vizcaya this weekend. We'll select a couple of random winners from the right responses in the comments. So we talked about how Chalfin was very much on Team Seahorse. And thanks to him, there are seahorses all over Vizcaya. If you can name some places other than the weather vane where you can find a seahorse at Vizcaya, please put that in the comments and we'll go ahead and select those. So Charlotte Dawn is asking, are there any books about Chalfin? Do you know of any?
You know, I'm not sure if there's any books about his life specifically, but he has been written about extensively in books about Vizcaya, just in terms of his role here. I'm sure that you could find a book about him in specific as well.
It doesn't look like we have any other comments so far. So if there any do come, sorry, if any other comments do come in late after we have ended the stream, just go ahead, leave them in the comments and we'll be back and respond in written form. Thank you so much to everyone for being here with us and we'll see you on the next stream.
Thank you guys so much.